You'll never guess who it is.
River Tuck?
And Mitchell Payne.
Mitchell Payne and River Tuck.
Well, I mean, if you think of like the Ram show, it's River Tuck and Mitchell
it
Payne.
It would be me first.
Yeah.
I don't think there's going to be a time I press this button and it doesn't come flying off. So.
I just never leave the cap on it anymore. I just go ahead and just take it off.
But it makes us look more professional.
Yeah, but then when you hit the button, it flies off, and that doesn't really look professional at all. Yeah. So
in case you're confused on what you're hearing over your airwaves right now, this is the Ram Show on 89.5 WAHS. I'm River Tuck, and he is Mitchell Payne.
What show in 2017 starts with a real intro
and
sensical talking? You just have to like start.
You were listening to a song, and now it's a show.
You were expecting more cool hot mops, but no, you get Ram Show.
Well, today we are going to be talking about something actually is on topic for the Ram Show. If this was any other show at the station.
For the first time in Ram Show history. Well, I mean, the first episode was a topic.
Yeah.
And for the Paul Glantz one, obviously, we had Paul Glantz and he's like the topic.
True. We have a solid like line drawn in the sand of what we're talking about, and we're going to limit our rambling. To a bare minimum. Okay, so how much do you know about mythology?
I remember there's this game called Age of Mythology, was an old strategy game that I played a lot.
Good RTS.
And so I have a good vibe for a lot of different places. I remember I did a big project on like Norse mythology, so I got some Norse, some Egyptian.
Oh, you got some Norse? You got some Norse knowledge?
Yeah, dude.
Good. Well, we're going to be talking about Norse.
Big old Yggdrasil, or however you say it. I never know how to say it.
Yeah, that's the tree. I can't say it either.
Because it's YGG. Like, how do you pronounce that Yig?
It's Ig. Scandinavians just like to mess with the rest of the world. Like,
yeah.
Why one G when you can have two?
GG.
GG. So we're going to be talking about Norse mythology, and we are specifically going to be talking about one god, and we're going to be talking about that one god in four different contexts.
And just as a general radio disclaimer, we're just talking about these things. We're not promoting any specific religions or whatnot. We're just having a discussion about Norse mythology.
I don't know how alive the Norse religion is nowadays. We might be.
There's the one listener out there.
We might be getting an email from an angry person who thinks we're invoking paganism again. But I could probably handle that email. If we lost our station license for that reason,
no,
I probably wouldn't.
There's
be
no
so
good
mad.
Reason for us
I,
to lose
I
our
wouldn't
station
be that
license.
Mad
I would be mad
for invoking paganism on air. Sorry,
stop.
The Vikings are coming, are making a comeback.
Didn't you have a thing you wanted to talk about?
Yeah, we were. Limit the rambling. Limit the rambling. Okay. Anyways, back to Baldur. So I'm going to introduce to you. What I believe to be the most pure interpretation of Baldur, because obviously with mythology, it is full of mediation and it gets interpreted, goes into movies and comics and whatnot. And, you know, and it's just a general kind of scene of things that mythology does get changed up a whole lot and kind of abused. And I don't appreciate it, especially Norse mythology, because Norse mythology does not have a lot of text behind it, which really upsets me as a mythology lover with Greek and whatnot. And we have a lot of history and we have a lot of text we can look at and drawings and whatnot. And we can, you know, we can still get a lot of information from that. But for the Norse, there really isn't a lot of original text. We derive all of our knowledge for Norse mythology from runes, old drawings, and information that has been passed down through generations and eventually put into some form of text. So it's really not fair. I think the Norse people did not do too good of a job at keeping up that. But we do have symbols. We do have artifacts that show that it was a real thing and someone didn't just write it at one point and pass it off like Scandinavians believed in. It was a real thing. Probably the most common symbol we have of Norse mythology that's still around today is Thor's hammer. It's
Mjolnir.
It's an upside down. It was a pendant that pretty much all Vikings would wear or anyone. We see it in tattoos a lot. Obviously, Mjolnir in the movie Thor, all of his different movies in Marvel and whatnot. Yeah. And it's still a pretty common symbol and whatnot for fortitude and, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah, it's like strength and endurance.
Yeah. So we're talking about the Norse god Baldur, which is, and there's like a billion different ways to pronounce it, just like with any other Norse god, and it's really frustrating. When I took mythology, we would get names on a piece of paper, and it would give us three different ways you're allowed to pronounce the name. There's like, so T-Y-R could be pronounced Tyr.
Tyr, I would say Tyr.
Tyr, that's how it is most commonly referred to, because he's in Smite, which is a video game about mythology, for our listeners who didn't know. Most people call him Tyr, but it's actually pronounced Tyr, supposedly. Tyr. So there's a hundred different, there's always different interpretations of it, and really how to pronounce it. It sucks. So it's definitely like Yggdrasil. Who knows?
Yggdrasil, Mjolnir. Yeah. That looks like Baldur Mjolnir, to me.
Mjolnir is about the only one I can say for sure that is the only way to
pronounce it. As long as they don't say like Mjolnir.
Yeah, no.
It's definitely a Y on that G.
So
J.
Baldur is pronounced bald, as in a head, a bald head. Baldur. Baldur is how it's supposed to be pronounced.
He's
and
bald, but he's
now
Baldur.
It's spelled so many different ways. B-A-L-D-R is the Norse way of spelling it, although sometimes there are umlauts on top of it and whatnot. But then Baldur, B-A-L-D-U-R, is also spelled like that. Sometimes it's spelled with an E, sometimes there's no A at all, stuff like that. It's just, it's a mess. It's a mess. We're doing our best as people nowadays to interpret this information. But anyways, so Baldur, for me, the original interpretation and the most original text, and I think the best explanation of Baldur comes from Edith Hamilton's book, which is a mythology textbook that we studied in my mythology class, so I'm a little bit biased, I'm going to admit. But the way that Edith Hamilton presents her information, and most of the book is based on Greek and Roman mythology, not so much Norse, is just a small couple chapters at the end of the book, because Norse doesn't have a lot of background. She doesn't touch on Egyptian or anything else. But the way that she presents her text in the book gives her a lot of ethos, and it definitely, you know, why are you smiling at me like that? It definitely gives her a lot of, what's the word I'm looking for?
Authority,
which is English for ethos. There's another one I'm looking for. Anyways, so it gives her a lot of authority to speak on the matter. She definitely knows her stuff, and the textbook is really not a textbook; it's just a book. And I actually got the the prefix from my my teacher. Got the warning before the mythology class. She's like, you know, we're just going to use this as reference material. It's kind of dry to read through the way she writes. And then she like refers to a picture of Edith in the back of the book. And she does look like kind of the picture was like in the 90s, but she's dressed in like some old, like 18th century, like gown. And I don't know.
That's like a new level of don't judge a book by its cover. It's don't judge a book by what the author dresses.
Yeah, no, it's definitely, but no, I don't think it's dry at all. I actually enjoy it. It's kind of straight to the point, and you get the mythology without all of the nonsense in between and all of the interpretations. So we're going to jump into the interpretations.
All right.
So now that I have presented to you where I have my knowledge of Baldur and what I believe the original text is, Baldur is a Norse god. His full name is Baldur Odinson, which is the common naming scheme for any Scandinavian name is just name son. So Ragnar's son, Odin's son.
But Odin is like the big man.
He's the father of Norse mythology. Mm-hmm. He's, you know, missing the eye, has the eye patch, and that guy. Anyways, so Odin, I'm trying to limit myself, stick to Baldur. I wish I could do a billion shows on Norse mythology. He is the son of Odin. He is the brother of Thor and Loki. So there's actually three brothers. Most people believe that it's Loki and Thor, but it's Loki, Thor, and Baldur. He's the son of Odin and Frigga, which is Odin's wife, or one of Odin's wives. In Norse mythology, they pretty much all have more than one wife. Baldur's wife's name was Nanna, which is actually a really obscure goddess, and there isn't a whole lot of story behind her. I think whenever they were creating the myth, it was kind of just, let's make someone up.
We need another person in there.
So yeah. And he's also the god of Forseti, which is another obscure god. Mainly the important gods in Norse mythology are Odin, Thor, Loki, Frigga, you know, the bunch. There's actually a lot of gods in Norse mythology, and not gods. There's humans, there's weird animal things, there's There's frost giants, stuff like that. So there are a whole bunch of different things in Norse mythology, but most of them are really obscure because we don't have any background. We have their name and what they were, and we don't really get why they were. We don't get what, because we know that mythology as a concept was an early form of explaining the unexplainable.
Right.
You know, mythology, myths would be created in, you know, way back times to explain thunder. Why is there light in the sky? Why what's going on? Oh, well, that's Thor. He's swinging his hammer. He's angry at people. He's stuff mean. Like that. Yeah.
Do they rock demigod stuff in Norse mythology? Do you know? Because you said like they have gods and they have humans.
Yeah.
But so demigod is always the god human guy.
They don't really use demigods as much. They have like, so there's warriors that were believed to kind of ascend. So the idea with Norse mythology and the reason it had the root in Scandinavian culture, paganism and whatnot, is because the belief is when you die, you have to die as a warrior. First of all, I'll get into that in a sec. You go to Valhalla, which is essentially a giant hall in the sky in Asgard, and you live not eternally. And this is the big difference between Norse mythology and every other mythology. Most other mythologies, dare I say religions, promise, you know, an eternal afterlife. Yeah. Norse mythology does not. Very, very contradictory. It promises you a afterlife, but not eternally, because Norse mythology is based around the end, kind of the end game of Ragnarok, which is the end of Asgard and Valhalla. Oh, yeah. There's a bunch of different interpretations of what Ragnarok is, when it's supposed to happen, and stuff like that. It's Baldur actually is a big piece of that. Supposedly, when Baldur dies is when Ragnarok will happen. I'm going to get more into that in a second. So back to Baldur, jumping back to there, that's why it has a place in Scandinavian culture, because we know that Scandinavians, you know, the Vikings is what they're most commonly known for being, and there was the common belief that if as long as you died with a sword in your hand and spitting in your enemy's face, you would go to Valhalla. So there's actually a story about a Jarl, which is basically a thane, so underneath a king. A Jarl in Scandinavian times who, while being, I'm not going to go into too much gruesome detail, while being killed, let's just say eliminated in a very gruesome fashion.
You already said it now.
There was a certain, it gets worse. There was a certain technique that was practiced by Scandinavians to eliminate their enemies. I'm not going to get into it, but while doing that, he still screamed in the face of his enemies and, you know, spit in the face and laughed at them while they were doing it, despite how gruesome what was said to be done to him was. So for that reason, it's commonly referred to him as being a prime example of how to get into Valhalla. You know, a short little how to get to Valhalla for dummies textbook, probably based on him.
Okay.
So Baldur is the Norse god of light. So he is referred to having complete domain over light. Whatever that means. I mean, you can interpret that in a whole bunch of different ways. He's supposed to have complete domain over light is all that is really said about that. He also is invincible, which is different from the other gods. The other gods are not entirely invincible. They can be killed by other gods, but they won't die, if that makes sense. But he is supposed to be entirely invincible because once he was prophesied to be the end of Ragnarok. Now, that part, I don't believe to be original text. That is not from Edith Hamilton. Other texts refer to the tale I'm going to tell to you being caused because it was prophesied Ragnarok would come when he died. The part that I do believe was true, I don't know where it came from, but I don't believe it stemmed from the Ragnarok anecdote, is that so Baldur was given invincibility by his mother Frigga because he was the most beloved god in all of Valhalla, all of Asgard. He was the most beloved god. He was beautiful, perfect, everything.
Was he the firstborn?
Yes, I think so.
Okay.
So favorite child.
Right.
So Baldur is the favorite child. You know what? He might have been the youngest. Because there's multiple interpretations of it. In Thor, they don't even bring up Baldur. In Marvel, they do, but not in the movies. More into that later. I'm pacing it out here.
Yeah.
So the story goes that she granted him invincibility by going all around of Midgard, which is Earth, and making every living being promise not to harm him. So she came back to Valhalla, and everyone now, seeing that he is invincible, thought it would be really funny or enjoyable to start trying to kill him. So all of his brothers, everyone in Valhalla, Asgard, started to shoot him with bows and arrows, and the arrows would just fly past his head. People would swing swords at him, and somehow it would never hit him. He could not be damaged in any way. So Loki, being Loki, as we all know, you know, the god of mischief, he wanted him to be gone. He wanted to see him hurt. So he went down to the planet, and for whatever reason, actually for a reason, Frigga did not think to make Mistletoe promise not to hurt him. Because mistletoe.
The plant?
Yeah. Kiss under mistletoe? Yeah.
Like, did she have to ask all the plants?
Yeah. She asked everything. Every living being.
Okay. So that includes... Why?
Because it's mistletoe. It's just one branch. Why would she think that it could ever have any chance of hurting him? So Loki went down, figured out that mistletoe never promised, got a branch of mistletoe, gave it to one of Baldur's brothers or friends, and guided his arm while invisible, guided his arm in throwing it, and it pierced right through Baldur and killed him on the spot with just a branch of mistletoe. His brother threw it at him, and it pierced through him and killed him. And Loki kind of guided his hand while being invisible. That's how Edith Hamilton refers to it actually happening. So after that, now Frigga's going crazy. She's sad. They're loading his body onto a funeral pyre, which is essentially a ship that you put the body in. Norse mythology, you'd put the body on a ship and then light the ship on fire and push it out to sea.
That's awesome.
Yeah, awesome.
I love that.
And so it was also said that his wife was so distraught with grief that she climbed on board and just died on the spot. Had a heart attack, died of sadness.
That's so sad.
Whatever interpretation. So they sent her off with him. So Frigga, being so sad, went down to Hel with one L, which is the goddess of death. Went down to her and said, "Bring back my son." You know, his soul is on his way down to her. Bring back my son. Let him come back to life. She said, "All right, if every being on Midgard, every being promises that they love and they don't, and that they weep for, if every being on Midgard weeps literal tears for Baldur, then we she'll let him come back." So Frigga raced around and made sure that everyone agreed that they were weeping and whatnot, until she came to the came to a giantress named Thanks. I don't know why. I don't question
okay.
it. I don't know why her name was Thanks. Anyways, came to the giantress Thanks, and giantress refused. Just said, "He never did anything for me, so I refuse." And Baldur was dead. Yep, just like that. One giantress was just like, "Nope." And then it is also referred to in other texts that it was Loki in disguise as the giantress, but I don't. I also don't believe that as original, because he just left that out as well.
That'd
and
be
it
cool
also,
explanation, though.
But it doesn't really make sense, because wouldn't that also mean that she would have to get Loki to promise, and she kind of should have known that? Yeah, so I just think there's some issues, because if it's every living being, does that mean she got all the Norse gods? Did she make Loki promise? Loki,
well, then she would have had to have done that the first time when Loki threw mistletoe at Baldur.
Well, he was just guiding his hand. So mistletoe can kill him, but not the people.
That's like the argument is like, weapons don't kill people, people kill people. I mean,
it's Norse mythology. Yeah, okay. We don't get too much explanation.
Okay.
So now we're going to jump into the variations of Baldur.
Okay.
We're going to give you a brief synopsis about the few interpretations, and I'm going to kind of describe how they stack up to the original one, how I see them, and kind of basically going to discredit all of them. Because that's the spirit. So we're going to start with the most obvious one. If you type Baldur into Google, this is what you're going to get. If you type in Baldur, Odin's son, you're not going to get a link to a Norse page. You're going to get Marvel to pop up. So Marvel's going to pop up. Baldur was interested as King Baldur, B-A-L-D-E-R, wrong. King Baldur in the comics, and he was... I don't know why he's drawn looking so evilly, but he's definitely not supposed to.
Yeah, he doesn't really look like a very light guy.
Supposed to be God of light, right?
With darkness on his eyes.
So, yeah, so he was introduced into the Marvel Universe as part of Thor's, stories and whatnot. And he had a big part in the stories, as far as they did in the comics. They believed that if he died, it would trigger Ragnarok. So basically, most of the Thor stuff in Marvel is centralized around Ragnarok. Okay. We actually got the movie this last year, I think, Thor Ragnarok. We got that, so we actually got to see how that all came together. And oh yeah, spoilers. So Baldur was actually not in that movie. He did not make an appearance in that movie, and there was really no reference to him, I don't believe, unless there was something on the walls, might have been a painting of him, but I don't think so, because they don't refer to the sister, who is not in Norse mythology, as being the oldest of kin, which is wrong, and in the comics it's wrong.
So she in the just comics, came out of
right,
nowhere.
But in the movie, it's wrong. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe they wanted a strong female lead instead of a guy. I don't.
She did feel out of place. Like, she was a villain. Just...
Baldur is in the Marvel comics and everything. He's never a villain.
He's just a nice guy.
He's supposed to be the god of light, and his death, however it comes about, is supposed to be signaling Ragnarok. We don't get that. Instead, we get in the movie, we get Odin's death. I already claimed spoilers, so sorry, guys. And then we get awesome battle. Thor turns into basically Zeus and is not Thor anymore.
It's still Thor, but
it's Thor, but they turned him into Zeus.
It's Thor without
a
hammer.
They ripped it off. Okay, they got rid of his hammer and they took out his eye.
I don't like spoilers too much, but
yeah. Anyway. And they gave him short hair. I understand why they did it from a movie perspective, but not correct. So Marvel obviously take a lot of leeways and they have a whole bunch of different interpretations and whatnot. So I don't believe that is at all a correct interpretation. I understand why they did it for sake of comic books and whatnot and storytelling. So the next one we're going to jump into is actually kind of interesting, and it's an interesting connection because we're both video game players, and I really love this video game, but you don't. So we're going to be talking about Battleborn. In Battleborn, there is a champion called Baldur. B-O-L-D-U-R. So there is there's not a link. There's not any sort of connection in his very brief biography whether he is linked to the actual god Baldur. But there are very many similarities that make me believe that they obviously got some of the ideas from him. So Baldur in the game is Baldur the Unbearable is a gruff axe-wielding native of Ekunar, who has survived the last two millennia through sheer stubbornness. Tough as a gnarled root, the Akuni dwarf carries only a rune-forged axe and shield into battle against any foe who dares land their dropship in his front yard. So, connections, obviously, he's, for some reason, dwarves and Norse mythology are connected very often. Now, there is some myth about dwarves in Norse mythology. Dwarves are supposed to be the greatest craftsmen of all time in Norse mythology, and they're supposed to have made the chains that hold down Fenrir, which is actually Loki's son, because he mated with a snake. He mated with a snake, and as children he had a wolf, a horse, the goddess of a death, and then another snake.
And he was the one who gave birth, right?
Yeah.
If I remember my mythology correctly. Yeah.
He gave birth, but he also had a wife. So weird, right? Yeah, weird.
Yeah.
Weird. Really weird. Anyways, so Baldur in this game, obviously, they don't really draw context. They don't draw a clear line to the actual Baldur, but they do rip off a whole lot of stuff from him. You know, references to the axe and the shield and the rage and runes of power is all very Norse-esque.
Yeah.
These are a lot of things from Scandinavian culture, the whole gnarled root analogy, and, you know, Baldur the Unbearable. It's just very Norse-esque, and you can tell that they got the idea from there, got the name, everything, but yet never go so far as to give him enough biography to any sort of reference of being Norse god.
But it's like you can tell it's inspired by.
For sure. So for the last one, we are going to be pulling from a book series by Riordan, I think is how you pronounce his name. Rick Riordan.
Riordan.
I think that's how you pronounce his last name.
Yeah, that looks about right.
Riordan. Yeah, sure. Anyways, Rick Riordan is a author of a bunch of mythology books, very much like Percy Jackson. So this is, but he delves more into all of the mythologies. He covers Greek in a book called something of the Trials of Apollo. Also does one about Asgard, stuff like that. So he covers many different mythologies in a young adult book setting. So we have from Baldur in Trials of Apollo, they actually reference his powers as powers, which is different because in other forms of mythology, they're not really powers so much as kind of divine gifts. And this is more like a superhero sense. And I think that's strange for a book that comes from, you know, is supposed to be about mythology. But anyways, so they reference his powers as photokinesis. As the god of light, he has absolute control and divine authority over light, which is correct. Amokinesis, as god of love, he has absolute control and divine authority over emotions of love and desire. Now, that is not true. In the actual myth, he's not the god of love, but he is the most beloved god. So you can see where they strayed like they from. They gave him a power because he was loved, but that's not entirely correct. And then they also give him invulnerability thanks to the efforts of his mother Frigg. This is wrong. It's Frigga. Why'd you have to take the A off? Like, what's the point? Baldur's body was invulnerable to seemingly every object that might potentially harm him, with his only known weakness being a branch of mistletoe. They got something right. So, got right. And then there's some trivia. Baldur is the only Norse god to die before Ragnarok, yet he is destined to be resurrected after Doomsday is over. So, he has a reference to Doomsday, which is not a belief that's founded in Norse mythology. In Norse mythology, essentially Ragnarok is meant to be the end times of Valhalla specifically, so not necessarily Asgard. It is supposed to lead to the end of Asgard and the end of Midgard. Basically, the end of everything is supposed to be Ragnarok. So Norse mythology has this kind of dark undertone, but not somber. It's not really so much a sad thing, almost. It's strange, because Norse mythology, I think, rather than... We know that Greek mythology was used to explain the unexplainable and did a really good job of that. All of the gods, you can very, very easily see what they explain. Yeah. You can see what, you know, scientific thing they explain. Norse mythology does some of that. Thor explains thunder and lightning. But besides that, there really aren't too many explanations. Norse mythology more has a root in the culture, which I think is, you know, very different from the other mythologies and makes Norse mythology special, because it was very, very heavily rooted in Norse culture. We know that Vikings were Scandinavian, followed Norse culture and paganism as, you know, their religion. But Vikings nowadays have had a bit of a surge in the last couple of years. There's the show Vikings, which has become really popular, kind of competing with Game of Thrones almost.
And even games like Skyrim, I mean, they have like the Nords, and it's all very, very Viking and cold and axes.
Yeah, axe cold Viking. That's pretty much
that's
Norse
mythology. That's how you know what it is.
Axe cold Viking. Now, the Vikings themselves are a bit of a kind of a myth in their own. Vikings weren't as popular as believed. We know that Vikings, obviously, historically, we know they had a lot of effect on culture. They were raiding England. They were the most dominant naval force in the world because they had ships that were able to go into shallow water and also sail the open sea. Made Vikings very deadly because they could show up anywhere in England. Obviously, it's in the British Isles. It's the Isles. And they had rivers that ran pretty much all throughout the British Isles. So they could show up pretty much anywhere. It didn't matter how inland your fort was or your castle or your village or whatnot. Vikings could pretty much show up there. And they really only had to show up with a couple ships. And Vikings originally started raiding because of capital. They started raising from a business perspective. That's what the misbelief of Vikings was, that they were just brutal and wanted to murder everyone and kill everyone. That's not true. They were businessmen.
Well, I mean, that's well, kind of how they got there.
Well, I mean, that was a means to an end. That's what they had to do, but that wasn't their original direction.
And their, I mean, granted, their whole afterlife revolves around them dying in a violent situation.
Well, it's,
they do require, it's like, you can't just die sitting at home eating potato chips. Like, you have to be doing something violent
in the Vikings TV show. And I struggle to reference it because it is a TV show, but it has surprised me by staying pretty close to the script. After the third season, I thought they were straying too far, and I was starting to have my suspicions, but they very quickly got back to original history and whatnot. So I think I could reference this. There is a character in the show, not that he is a Norse myth or anything. There is a character in the show who was in the main character's war party, and the dude was like 70 years old. Probably not. He looked 70 by our standards, but back then he was probably 40. He was very, very old, and you know, he had white hair and everything, but he was in a war party, and the son of the main character was kind of like, why are you here? Why don't you go home and enjoy your life? He's like, I can't. I have to die on the battlefield. And the guy genuinely had a hate for, like, living. It wasn't somber. It was like, oh, I hate my life. It wasn't that. It was that he wanted to die. He had been in so many battles and watched all of his brethren and all of his companions die in battle and ascend to Valhalla, and he was angry that he couldn't. But he couldn't,
theoretically, you're just jealous of the afterlife. Which, I mean, in that perspective, is a totally.
It was that he wanted his
rest.
He wanted to be dead, but he didn't. But he couldn't. You know, he couldn't just like go out there and stand out in the open and get shot by an arrow because he wouldn't make it to Valhalla. He had to die fighting with all his will.
Yeah.
So in turn, he kept getting better as a fighter. I suppose. I mean. You keep getting better as a fighter, and now you're not dying, and you're like, well, I just want to die, but you have to keep fighting harder and harder. Yeah, it's
a really sad paradox.
Yeah, it is. It's a little bit difficult. So that you see the paradox in the character in the show. He's, you know, like, I really just want to die, and then in the next battle scene, he dies, and it's kind of like, and he gets to have his happiness and ascend and whatnot. Anyways, so... back to the Norse mythology and the Vikings. The Vikings really made their move from a business standpoint because it was just seen as a way to gain additional capital. Farmers, rich businessmen who controlled farms and whatnot, they saw it as an additional way. Invest in a ship fairly cheap, and you can go and raid. Once open sea travel was figured out by the Vikings, in the show they claim that it was figured out using a sunstone, and essentially the way it works is you use a sun style and a sunstone. You have a wooden like basically plate. It's all flat, has some lines on it just for reference sake, but you don't really need them, and it has just a single middle metal pole sticking out of the middle of it, and you put it in a bucket of water, and when the sun shines down, the sun shines down on it, it would cast a shadow, right? You record what way the shadow is facing, so you like make a mark, you carry like a piece of paper, you know make a mark, so you record where it is when you leave port, and then you check it every so often, and okay, if the shadow has started to go this way, I've obviously started to steer too far to the left. See, yeah. But then they had the problem, well, it's cloudy. What are we gonna do? We're in the Great North, it's cloudy, how are we gonna do it? Well, then they found a sunstone. I don't know what stone it's supposed it actually is. They call it a sunstone. I don't know what actual
what
stone
is a
it is.
Sunstone?
It's just a stone that it's a magnifying glass. Stone that if you hold it up to the sky, it makes the sun shine through even despite through clouds. I don't know what actual stone it was. Maybe it was like opal or.
But then wouldn't that just depend on where you hold it? Like if you hold it.
Well, you
like
hold it up
side,
in the sky and you
get guessing
it around
where
until
the sun
you figure
is.
Out where the sun is.
Okay.
And then as soon as it starts blaring you in the eye, you're like, oh, I got it.
That's
and then
where
you just kind of angle it.
Gotcha.
And then you can still get your shadow and whatnot. So that's in the show, Vikings, that's how they supposedly figured out open sea travel. And that's probably pretty reliable.
That makes sense.
We know around the time how navigation was done in the open sea. And it was rare. It was very rare. And the fact that they were able to do it with their ships that were able to go in shallow water is kind of crazy, because originally Vikings, their raiding could only be on the shore. They could only stay so close to land, which meant they had to continuously raid what is now Russia, and that was not working out for them because they raided them dry. If they were to go any farther, they were risking too many people. They were going too far into the the north. They were going too far into Russian land. They were, it was just, it wasn't going to work, and too many people were dying on these trips. So they basically exhausted all the resources there. So now they had to go out into the open sea. They figured out their open sea travel. So it was seen as a way to gain additional capital. You buy a ship and you fill it with soldiers and you send it off. But what they figured is the English didn't really have any sort of other competition. They didn't really have anyone else. They didn't have any sort of issues as far as someone trying to stop them. They really, the English weren't like prepared for that. They didn't have fortifications or anything for, like their, what do you call it? A church. It's like a church, but back then a cathedral or whatnot. Mm-hmm. So they had cathedrals filled with monks and obviously like priceless artifacts and whatnot. And they weren't fortified. So the Vikings could pretty much just roll up on shore and take whatever. You know, they could just roll up, and there was just a bunch of monks who didn't really have a lot of defense from all of that.
Yeah, I see that. I gotta go.
We're gonna have we're gonna wrap it up here.
Yeah.
Mitchell's gonna sign off, and I'll finish up the show real quick.
Anything else you want to say? You can just hit the stop recording button.
Yeah, I got it. Okay. Thanks, Mitch.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is fun hanging out with y'all. See you next time.
I'll finish my little anecdote while you're gone. Yeah. I'll be sure to fill you in because I know you'll be missing out. Bye, Mitchell. And we're back. So Mitchell's gone. He had to go. His mommy wanted him. he has to leave studio. So I'm gonna wrap up my little presentation. So like I was saying, the Vikings found this as, you know, an additional way for capital and whatnot, and it did turn into what we know Vikings to be, very gruesome and whatnot. And this religion, paganism and Norse mythology, fit very well with that kind of culture because it made them vicious. I mean, Norse mythology was very vicious. I mean, you had to die fighting. You had to die with a sword in your hand. You had to continually struggle. You couldn't just... So it worked out well with their culture, and we can see where it had its roots in the fact that it bred very powerful soldiers and a very powerful fighting source and made very resilient people just from their beliefs. So we know that Norse mythology was more of a religion than Greek or Roman or really any others. Obviously, Egyptian had different connotations and whatnot as far as their culture, because it was just a different time and a different setting. But with Norse mythology being brutal as it was, Baldur is an interesting god, being the god of light, Frigga being but Baldur being the god of light was a kind of an interesting thing. To have a completely beloved god doesn't really seem to fit in with the archetype of what we had. I mean, we had Thor, who was the god of thunder, who's vicious. He punished those who didn't believe in him, you know, would punish them on their voyages. So if they were basically, you know, if there's a failed voyage, they blamed people not believing in Thor enough. And same thing with Odin. Odin was the god of wisdom, so you'd pray to Odin if you needed, you know, help in a hard time, or you really needed to figure something out, etc., etc. And then additionally, there were other gods that represented everything that basically centered around war, strength, things like that. But then you have Baldur, and it's kind of a one-off. So the multiple interpretations of Baldur, I don't really have a problem with them straying from the original source material, because I think it's an interesting opening into what Baldur could have been. I think that Baldur needs to be explored more as a god. I would love to see him show up in the Thor movies and Marvel, because seeing stuff in a movie format is always great, having visuals and whatnot. And I would like to see him show up in more books and whatnot, and, you know, stuff like that, because Baldur as a god, we really only know the story of the mistletoe, and the legend of the mistletoe and Loki. We know he was the god of light. We know... That's really about it. From the original text of Edith Hamilton, that's all that we get about Baldur. And if I am to say that that is the original text and where we draw the line, I would venture that the idea that Ragnarok was caused around, was based around when he died, or that he was a stepping stone in that. I think that it could be true, mainly because that is referenced for other gods. I think when other gods were referenced of dying, it also said that Ragnarok would come if they died. So I don't think that it was specifically a Baldur thing at all. I think it was, you know, different. Odin was, if Odin was to die, Ragnarok would come, Thor, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it was still, I think it was kind of a broader picture, and I think it was just the belief, if our gods die, Valhalla is going to die. And I think that was used practically for, if we don't believe enough in our gods and they die somehow, then our religion will fade and our paganism will somehow fade out and whatnot. So I think that that was the more practical sense of how Baldur got that, and I can see where the multiple interpretations got it. But as far as the three, Marvel, I think obviously strays too much because they can't really stick to their guns with the movies and the comics. He's referenced in the comics, but the comics still present him incorrectly, and in the movie as well, he doesn't even show up. He's replaced by a female lead, which isn't grounded in the actual myth at all. And then we have Baldur from the video game Battleborn. We've seen Baldur's name is used a lot in video games, but has never manifested in the form of a character except for in this game, as far as I'm aware. So this form of Baldur seems to be correct as far as the manifestation of him as a character, a playable character and whatnot, something that you can actually see and have visuals and whatnot. But it's really not grounded in Norse mythology. The game doesn't reference Norse mythology, while the race that Baldur from the game is from is kind of based in Norse mythology. They're supposed to be a very woodland people, and they're all great warriors, whatnot. So that you can see the connection there. So there are a lot of connections, and it is drawing from the idea of a Norse god, but I think maybe they wanted to do something like Thor or Loki, but just didn't want to go that straightforward with it. You know, wanted original character development, stuff like that. I mean, video game makers have a mind of their own and make decisions on their own for whatever reason. And then we lastly have him referenced in the Asgardian tales and whatnot for the Rick Riordan. I'm probably butchering his name again. Riordan. I want to say Riordan because it sounds cool, but it's Riordan. The Rick Riordan novels, The Trials of Apollo, and the rest, the Tales of Asgard, I think, is the one that Baldur is referenced in. They kind of misinterpret Baldur to show him more as this weird superhero archetype, which isn't entirely correct. They call him Baldur the Beautiful, which is correct, God of Light, but then they also call him God of Love, Beauty, Peace, Forgiveness, Spring, Purity, and that's definitely not correct. He isn't referenced as that or having any powers that would go along with that, and it's definitely not correct. And they also make links between him and other gods, Cupid and Apollo, which I see why, for the sake of the book, and making a sort of continuity between all of the different books and, you know, whatnot. That definitely makes sense, but it's still straying far from the original intended text. I think that's all I have for you guys today. I hope you enjoyed my little slice of Norse mythology, religion, paganism, whatnot. Little rant missing Mitchell right now, but I'll sign off for him. And thank you for listening, and have a good day.
It's Leonie, and you're listening to WAHS 89.5 Auburn Hills.
Drifting like it's 1974, dressing like the Rolling Stones. Hey ho, let's go get some more like young Ramones. Some nights feel like every night. This one feels brand new. Only got bad things on my mind when I'm with you. 1984, dancing like the Talking Heads. Last call, 40s at the corner store to take to bed. Tell me that you need me on the floor, pass out in your dirty clothes. Ask me what the hell I'm looking for, like you don't know. You're making it so easy. With you, and so it goes. We found.